One. I want to welcome you to today's Council on Foreign Relations meeting, the title of which is Women's Rights as Human Rights. It's the path to full participation. I want to start by introducing the fabulous women who are sitting to my left. Chelsea Clinton, as you know, is vice chair of the Bill Hillary and Chelsea Clinton Foundation. She has a big role in the Clinton Global Initiatives, as well as the CGI University, which works to empower the next generation of change, as well as the Clinton Health Access Initiative. She also focuses on the foundation's initiative, No Ceilings, the Full Participation Project, so obviously relevant to today's discussion. You probably all know she's also a former management consultant with Kinsey. She made stops in finance and in media with NBC News, and she is also a new mom to baby Charlotte. So as a working mom, welcome to the juggle. And to her left is Anju. We were supposed to, as a program note, be joined by Geeta Rao Gupta, but four UNICEF workers were killed in Somalia by a roadside bomb. So she is attending their funeral today. But we miss her, and we wish that the best for her and everyone at the family of UNICEF. But to my left, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing Anju Malhotra, who is Geeta's colleague at UN. She's the principal advisor for gender and development at UNICEF. She has worked to develop the Gender Action Plan for a number of years. Before that, she was vice president for research at the International Center for Research on Women. And before that, she was also assistant professor at the Center on Population, Gender, and Social Equality at the University of Maryland. And she joins us with her prestigious knowledge and experience. So we are going to get underway with this idea that it's been 20 years since Chelsea, your mom, went to the Beijing conference as First Lady and made the proclamation, really, that women's rights are human rights. And for the next 20 years, there have been policy initiatives and all sorts of political momentum behind that. Give us a sense of some of the gains and some of the gaps along the way and what that was like, you know, as a 19-year-old looking forward as that generation of women.
Well, thank you, and thank you to the council for hosting us this morning. I am so excited to be here, particularly because of Rachel Vogelstein, who is here at the council doing such important work on women and girls, and who was a core driver and author of the full participation report and roadmap forward. So I'm always grateful to have an excuse to be back with Rachel, and to be on the stage with Anju, who has done such tremendous work, particularly in helping ensure that kind of more people have access and understanding of what UNICEF does and how UNICEF's work is intimately tied to what we're talking about here this morning. I was actually 15 when my mom was in Beijing, and I remember vividly watching her speech in that sort of kind of beautiful pink suit in which she said kind of so emphatically something that was censored at the time in China and was quite controversial, that women's rights are human rights and human rights are women's rights. And as we think about sort of the 20 years from 95 until today, there's sort of two top lines. One, as we start the report with, you know, it's never been a better time to be born a girl or to be a female in the world. And two, we have made real progress when we think about education, health, economic opportunity, and participation for women and girls, but we are very far from success. Kind of in no country does a girl have the same rights, opportunities, and social and cultural expectations as her brothers or kind of as the boys in her cohort. And so a couple of illustrative examples. When we think about education, we've almost entirely closed the primary school education gap around the world, largely because we've removed school fees so that parents don't have to make a decision as to whether or not it's sort of equally of important value to send a girl as a boy to school. That's not true everywhere. There's still gaps that remain, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, but we've almost closed the primary school gap. But the picture looks radically different when we look at secondary school, in which the gap sort of widens and then yawns, particularly in some countries. When we think about Mozambique or Burkina Faso or Niger, fewer than 10% of girls graduate from secondary school or high school. So we've made real progress, but to ensure that sort of every girl has the educational opportunities, we know we need to do more, like ensuring that secondary school fees are removed in the same way that primary school fees have largely been in the last couple of decades. And then sort of one other example in which we've not made as much progress. In 1995, the labor force participation rate for women was 55% at a global level. 55% of women 16 or older were either in school or working in the formal economy. In 2014, it was 55%. So that's not progress, that's inertia. And we know a lot about why we have been stuck. There are a number of countries in which women are still legally prohibited from working in certain jobs, and that's actually not only in what we generally think of as the developing world. In Russia, they're more than 400 against in pay. In many countries, women can't open their own bank accounts or take out their own loans without a male co-signatory, and so that radically diminishes the prospects for women entrepreneurship. And so we know kind of we've made progress in some areas. We know a lot about what works, and we need to be doing more of that. And we know there are other areas where we have kind of lamentably not made progress. And we know a lot about what the barriers are that we need to continue to overcome so that we truly unlock the full potential for women and girls.
Anju, let's get you to talk a little bit about the barriers to full gender equality. I mean, we're talking about ages in which young girls move into more household roles, and that remains a barrier, whether it's, you know, child marriage or starting a family. These are issues that still hold women back.
Yeah, it's both, as Chelsea says, we have made progress on many fronts. I was in India a couple of years ago, and the colleague who was with me took me to his village and was showing me that, you know, 20 years ago, his sister had to go in a rickshaw because she was the only one of two girls who was going to school, and it was so unusual that she had to be taken in a rickshaw, otherwise she'd be harassed by people around. And when we were there, pretty much every girl was going to school, you know, all these little girls and even teenage girls dressed in uniforms going to school. That's the big change that's happened. You see them everywhere. But at the same time, if we look at some of the numbers right now, UNICEF just did a recent calculation, 700 million women alive today were married as children. And when you look at that number, I mean, 700 million, that's staggering. How many other indicators can you look at that are that huge? And if you think about 700 million women who wouldn't have been married at 13 or 14 or 9 or 16, what they would have been doing. They would have been going to school. They would have been part of an economy. They wouldn't have been dying in childbirth. They wouldn't have had children die in childbirth. They would have been moving their families and economies forward. So that's a huge potential lost. And that's part of what we're looking at. We are now estimating that in the next 30 years, there'll still be 700 million girls married as children. Even though rates are declining, we have more adolescents in the world today than we used to have, and so more girls are at risk. So we need to find ways of investing in those girls, not just at the primary school, but especially during those middle adolescent years. We were talking about my daughter going to college in September, you know, and she has dreamed that, and she's excited, and there are just so many girls who are losing their childhood, you know, at 7 or 8, they're fetching water, they're doing household chores, and then that's the vision that their family and their society has for them. And it's not unusual. I mean, it's not that people somehow think it's always the right thing to do, but it seems to be the only thing to do, unless there are other opportunities and other push to for them to have alternatives.
And I would just say, to build on what Anju was saying, I think that child marriage really illuminates why we need both changes in kind of formal laws as well as cultural and social normative shifts.
Sure.
And so when we think about the 700 million women who are alive today who were married before 18, many of whom were actually married before 15, we know that changes in laws really do impact kind of whether or not girls are married before they're really of a legal age to consent. And so I think it's important that those of us that have platforms like this and like CFR does highlight when countries do make those shifts. So I know Malawi in the last couple of months has moved to eliminate child marriage by making it illegal for people under 18 to get married. And that's hugely important, and CFR has done a good job of highlighting that, because I think things that are sort of in the legal domain often are seen as sort of not as sexy and not as interesting, but they're actually hugely important. And you know, this is also an area where I think the United States still has work to do. I mean, in the US, you know, there are many states that still have laws on the books that permit children to get married, you know, albeit with parental consent. But you know, in Massachusetts, it's still legal for a 12-year-old to get married. Right? That, I think, is appalling. Yeah, I know you're all sort of looking around. And in other states, yeah, it's 13, exactly. 14.
Talk about cultural norms.
And they're draconian. I mean, they're laws that have been on the books literally for centuries. But I think to ensure that kind of we have kind of the moral authority as a country to kind of continue to make the case for why investing in women and girls isn't just the right thing to do, but the smart thing to do.
And that moral authority is an echo to the Beijing conference 20 years
Completely.
Ago. So Anju, let me get you to talk a little bit about what we discussed was the low-hanging fruit that was picked in the last 20 years. And moving forward, that path is a little bit more difficult. The work gets a little bit harder because there isn't as much easy low-hanging fruit. How do you prioritize as you look forward for the next 20 years?
I think we have learned some lessons. We paid attention in the last 20 years, but there are two really missing pieces that as we move forward that we need to think about. And the two words that come to my mind are scale and ambition. I say scale because we tend to often have done projects and initiatives that focus on women and girls' well-being or empowerment, but they've always been by NGOs run, you know, done for 200 girls, 500 girls, maybe if we're really lucky, you know, 5,000 girls. But when we're talking about millions, we really need to think about laws, policies, systems change, how the health system works, how the education system works, what fees are like for secondary schooling, for example, what kind of private sector investment will go into that kind of education, and then ambition. So I'm concerned that we're going to be setting the new sustainable development goals this year at the UN, and girls' education isn't getting quite the attention that it was getting. It, I mean, if there is one magic bullet in development, girls' education is it. And we somehow seem to be quite complacent that we have gotten girls into primary school. And as the world's moving forward in the 21st century, you know, people who are advantaged, boys, rich girls, are getting tertiary level education. They're getting STEM education. They're part of a world of technology. And we're still looking at giving just basic primary education to girls. Of course they should have primary education. Nobody's saying they should have it at the expense of secondary education at the expense of primary. But we really need to be ambitious for these girls. We want them to have access to technology. We want them to be part of the 21st century, or they're not going to be able to have the power to make the choices that we really want them to make. So we need to think about not microfinance for women, we need to think about finance for women. You know, we need to up the game quite a bit.
Chelsea, let me move you to the economic sphere a little bit. I know that you are very involved and lead the No Ceilings, the full participation plan at the Clinton Foundation. But I also, you know, give us some insights, a little sneak peek into your life as a new mom too, because, you know, I know it's changed your perspective a little bit. It's changed your parents' perspective. Do they like have a nickname? Does grandma and grandpa have a nickname?
No nicknames yet. yeah, I mean, we were talking earlier before we walked out, you know, and I didn't know that I could care any more emphatically about kind of what I already cared about until I became a mom and until I had a daughter. And so, you know, everything that we're talking about and everything that we sort of obsessively kind of think about and talk about in my family and at the foundation around how we solve some of the systemic challenges that Anju was just talking about now has a visceral dimension and to complement the kind of intellectual kind of arguments. And so absolutely, I mean, when we think about educational opportunities or kind of health opportunities for Charlotte or maternal health, that has a different resonance for me. I mean, an area where we have made progress as a world is around maternal health. You know, we've cut the maternal mortality rate by more than 40% in the last 20 years. And that's tremendous progress, but still 800 women every day die of preventable complications related to childbirth and their pregnancies. So I now feel a different level of responsibility to try to help to continue to decrease that number. And so I'm so proud of the work that we're doing through the Clinton Health Access Initiative to help decrease the price and then increase the accessibility of reversible, long-lasting, injectable contraceptives so that more women around the world have more private access to make the right family planning choices for themselves and for their children. So I think, you know, for me, just Charlotte being in my life, that kind of motivates me to work even harder and even smarter and to try to be more ambitious. I mean, I think what Andrew said is so right, kind of that I hope with the Sustainable Development Goals, we are really ambitious because I do think increasingly there's a recognition that kind of fully incorporating women and girls is the closest thing that we have to a silver bullet in development, and yet at the moment our commitments aren't reflective of that kind of recognition, and I hope that we'll get there before September.
But I loved what you said about your dad and how hands-on he is.
He is, and that, you know, it's, as we were also talking about, I mean, men and boys have to be part of ensuring full participation for women and girls, and that's something that, you know, the UN community more broadly has really put a focus on this year in advance of September, and I think that's so smart. And I think it's something that all of us could learn from.
Studies show that women actually do better in the workplace when they see their fathers and male figures in their lives doing household duties.
Completely.
So, Anju, let me get you to talk a little bit about how to frame some of these issues going forward, because these gender equality issues are not necessarily moral issues, although they have a moral component, but they should be seen by governments and NGOs as a strategic issue, that it's good for development, it's good for the economy.
Yes, absolutely. I think, and more countries that are, we're noticing, you know, as a range of countries move from lower income to middle income and then from middle income to high income, we start seeing that shift in their perspectives. Yeah, Vietnam, for example, is a place where, you know, on the one hand, you would think that it's moving so fast, maybe there are no gender inequalities. But that's not true. You look, and especially, for example, in the indigenous communities, the inequalities are quite wide. But it is a country that is determined to have middle income status. And then they realize, well, we can't have middle income status if a large proportion of our population is uneducated and it doesn't have health care and isn't part of the political and civil processes. And I think that sort of just, the sheer basic simplicity of it, just like women's rights are human rights, and you know, now we say, duh, well, you know, why was that such an awakening moment? Similarly, I think that duh moment is coming, that how can any country consider itself be developed or sustainable if 50% of its population doesn't have the same rights and opportunities? It's impossible. So that sense is dawning on governments that are progressive, or at least the governments that are ambitious to move to a sustainable development agenda. Unfortunately, that's not the case everywhere. Not all governments are accountable to their people the way they should be. But also, I think the message, at least as UNICEF, that we're trying to send is that it's not like you're going to wave a magic wand when people are 40 and 50 and change their perspectives and their norms and their thinking. It is that we invest in children, and it's not that you're going to have men and boys start thinking differently, but they might, but it's when you have to teach them from early on. It's the environment that we provide to children from birth to through adolescence that really shapes when boys see girls going to school with them, and when boys see girls, you know, in India there was that horrible rape case last year, if you remember, and one of the most amazing things was that it wasn't just women out on the street, but men were out on the streets, and those were young men who had gone to school with girls and who understood girls as people. And that's one of the most important things that we can do, that women are people, girls are people that require the same investments and the same rights, same opportunities for them to prosper, but also their countries to prosper.
And this is something that isn't only a conversation among developing countries, sort of middle-income or ambitious to be middle-income countries, but also among developed economies. I mean, this is a very public conversation in Japan right now. You know that, yes. that Prime Minister Abe has started and is continuing to push forward because all the research says, you know, out of Japan, out of the OECD and OECD and the IMF, you know, that if kind of labor force participation rates were equal among women and men in Japan, you know, the Japanese economy would have an additional quarter GDP growth per year. You know, for an economy that grows, you know, maybe at 1% and has had a pretty anemic decade, you know, that's a very powerful incentive to ensure that women enter the labor force now, but also that sort of the educational system is reimagined to ensure that kind of more girls want to grow up and enter the labor force. And something I really respect about how Prime Minister Abe is talking about this and thinking about this from a policy standpoint is that he recognizes ensuring that more women are in the labor force has many constituent parts. Mm. So sort of the educational dimension, ensuring there's more kind of elder care available to support older kind of men and women so that kind of middle-aged and younger women don't have to play those roles and can enter the labor force, and kind of recognizing that kind of many things have to coalesce to enable women to enter the labor force in Japan in a major way. But he's clearly committed to figuring it out because, as Anju said, he recognizes it's in Japan's long-term self-interest to do
right.
so.
There needs to be self-interest. In this context, we're talking about women's rights, and I think I would be remiss if I didn't ask about the presidential race that's underway, and the Clinton Foundation keeps bubbling up a little bit. And as vice chair, I felt I needed to ask you, you know, I know that there's been a rules change in terms of money and donations, but a lot of people have questioned, for example, you know, why did the foundation take money from Saudi Arabia when they didn't treat women, you know, as well as perhaps they could. And there's questions even this morning in the New York Times about money coming from Ukraine. And there's this perception that were favors done in exchange for funding. So I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
There are lots of questions in that. You know, we have always partnered with kind of governments, NGOs, foundations who believe the work we do is important. So whether that's around women and girls or smallholder farmers or the injectable, long-lasting, reversible contraceptives that we talked about earlier. And so what the Clinton Foundation has said is that we will be kind of even more transparent, even though Transparency International and others have said we're among the most transparent foundations. We'll disclose donors at a quarterly basis and not just an annual basis. My role as the vice chair, you know, I have a fiduciary responsibility to the, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people being impacted by that work, and our staff on the ground in 36 countries, thinking across the Health Access Initiative and the foundation. So I very much kind of believe that that's the right policy, that will be kind of even more transparent, that to kind of eliminate any questions while we're in this time, we won't take new government funding, but that the work will continue as it is. I think that's the right choice for the people who are being affected by that work.
You have a very robust role as vice chair. You're going to Africa next week. But I'm curious, you know, you also spoke at some number, like 200 universities during the 2008 campaign. Can we see you out on the campaign this time around?
Oh, goodness. My mom's only been running for about a week and a half.
And never too early to ask.
And, you know, I'm so proud of her. So, I mean, as a daughter, I'm unabashedly and unapologetically biased towards her. And I hope that Charlotte feels the same way about me. She grows up, may I be so lucky.
She's 6 months old, I suspect it's true.
Oh, thank you, yes, yes. When she looks at me, she's like desperately trying to crawl.
Exactly.
On a serious note, my life is very different now than it was in 2008. I'm a mom, and my first responsibility is to my daughter, and to ensure that she feels the same way that I always felt, that I was the most important person in the world to my parents. And I have a job that I love at the foundation, and so very much for this year, you know, I plan on largely kind of being here, and when traveling, you know, traveling for the foundation, as we talked about, I'm going to Africa next week, and you know, I think we'll see kind of what evolves, because certainly, you know, I think all of us try to figure out how to balance roles in our lives, and part of me kind of being a good mom to Charlotte is also kind of being a good daughter to my mom and ensuring that people understand why I believe she's the right person to lead our country at this moment in time. How I'll figure that out, is an open question, but I'm committed to doing so, and all advice is very appreciated.
Well, you'll get a lot of tweets, no doubt. At this point, I want to open the conversation to our members and encourage you to ask questions. I want to start, just because Chelsea's been speaking for a while, with a question for Anju. If someone, you just take the microphone, stand up, limit yourself to one question, please, and keep it concise. Who would like to take the microphone? Do you want to? The person closest to this side, and then we'll take you next, okay?
Thank
you. State your name and affiliation.
Paula DePerna, the NTR Foundation. I was very moved this morning by a statement by the Special Rapporteur for the Rights of Migrants regarding the catastrophe in the Mediterranean and elsewhere, and I know Queen Rania has been essential in Jordan. And I wondered, you know, people are not talking about women, displaced women, stateless women, and the degree to which you can inject, as UNICEF, into the UN process some highlighting of stateless children and women. I think that would be very important, and I wondered what kind of role you can play in that regard.
Thank you, excellent question.
You raise a really important point. You know, UNICEF is currently facing so many what we call level 3 emergencies. There is, in the last year, we have seen experiences of violence, and I'm sitting here today as our colleagues of mine have lost their lives. And we're honoring them. Last year, we were in the same situation in Afghanistan. Two of our colleagues lost lives. And it is part of a process where entire economies are being disheveled, and women and children, particularly in Syria and other places, are suffering. And UNICEF, and I think the world, needs to really understand and appreciate that fragile states are not just harmful for the sustainability of the world that we are a part of, because every day that we ignore that fact, our stability is threatened, but that there are millions of people who face a generation that's going to be lost. And if we want to reverse that, then investing not just in the protection, but the well-being of those people is critical. And one of the most interesting experiences I had was I was at the Zaatari camp in Jordan, where the Syrian refugees are there, and it's actually really heartbreaking to see how that camp has become established over time. You know, there were 20,000 people there a while back, but now it's a city. I mean, UNICEF used to, you know, bring water by trucks, but now we've dug boreholes. And because all these people need water. But what's interesting is that what we've gone from is from having just the basic food and water and shelter type of argument, but to really protection in terms of protection against sexual violence that a lot of women and girls are in particular are facing in those circumstances. But also what women in particular are asking is education for their children. And this is surprising and stunning, but that's what brings stability. It's the access to basic health care, and it's access to basic schooling that makes them feel like there may be stability and there's investment and there's a possibility of eventually you know, getting out of this situation. It's the best reason for hope. So UNICEF is investing hugely, and I know that there is in talk right now about increasing setting up a fund for humanitarian assistance that's beyond what we have done in the past, and it's certainly something that deserves a lot of attention.
Yes, we need a microphone.
Hi, my name is Bruce Knotts. I'm the director of the Unitarian Universalist United Nations Office. We fully support and are trying to get strong. Right now, of course, the Sustainable Development Goals are pretty much fixed, but I think the battle now is on the targets and indicators, and we want those to be as strong as they possibly can for women's education. I want to draw you out on another aspect of women. Security Council Resolution 1325 and subsequent calling for greater participation of women in peace and security issues. And if I could offer one example, I'm thinking of Navi Pillay, former High Commissioner for Human Rights. She was on the War Crimes Tribunal for Rwanda. She was the only woman justice there, and when the cases were brought to her, there were no allegations of gender-based violence. And she was incredulous. She said, that's impossible. Mm-hmm. So she did a little bit of digging, and then there was an avalanche of allegations. But it took a woman to do that. Yep. So as women suffer disproportionately in conflict, we find they are not at the table when it comes time to resolve these conflicts. And I'd like your comments on that.
Great question. Thank you.
Chelsea, did you want to say?
Sure. I mean, I think, you know, for others who may not be as familiar with 1325, I mean, that resolution's now 15 years old.
Yeah.
So this is not something that kind of recently surfaced as a priority and that was still working toward. And I think, you know, there are a couple of kind of things embedded in your question that help kind of highlight the path forward. You know, although there have been kind of women on every tribunal since 2000, often it's just been one. Right? And so while it is certainly important kind of that women are at the table until kind of there are more women kind of helping to curate and drive the conversation, I don't think we'll sort of see the systematic shift to ensure that kind of issues that disproportionately affect kind of women and children are kind of core to kind of what follows after a tragedy. And so I think you know part of it is sort of kind of moving away from sort of single representation as somehow success. Or kind of, again, mistaking progress for success. I would argue we see the same thing kind of in the political sphere. 12% of national parliaments in 1995 were women. It was 18% in 2014. So you can either think, oh, wow, right, there was a 50% increase.
Right.
That seems like a really exciting statistic until you realize it's still 18%.
Yeah.
Right? And I think that kind of there are similar analogs to that kind of in the security conversation, not only kind of from a legal tribunal standpoint, but when we think about who the kind of peace and security negotiators are, whether at sort of a local level or an international level. And I know that's something that UNICEF has been very focused on to ensure that children are on the agenda, because I think, again, often kind of women are talked about as somehow being just fully representative of family issues. And while it's terrific that kind of women's sanctity of person is now kind of part of peace and security negotiations, children's sanctity of person has to be as well, given that they similarly suffer incredibly high rates of violence and tragically sexual assault, particularly in refugee situations and post-conflict situations. And that's something that UNICEF continues to push forward, and we're not quite kind of where we need to be in terms of what our expectations are of tribunals in terms of constitution or commitment to dealing with certain issues or negotiators. But again, we've made progress, we just have to keep pushing forward.
Yeah, and I would just add that this point of having a critical mass of representation makes a huge difference. We know, for example, and your point about political representation and political leadership, I mean, we don't have a woman president in this country yet, right? So, so there is that critical representation matters, and there are so many countries where quotas on women's political participation and women being at the table at the highest levels in boards, Norway is an example, actually does make a difference. And so that requirement of representation isn't token, but it's something serious.
It reminds me of the Sandra Day O'Connor quote, when she said that her happiest day was, I guess it was the notorious RBG when Ruth Bader Ginsburg walked into the Supreme Court. I saw more hands in here. Let's go to one in the back, in the green.
Good morning, thank you. It's Minky Warden from Human Rights Watch.
Hi.
Thank you all for a wonderful discussion this morning. I wanted to return to a question that Juju put earlier, which is to discuss some of the outliers, Gulf countries, Saudi Arabia. And given the leverage that CGI might have, is it possible to take up issues like access to sport for 12 million girls in the country, denial of physical education, denial of sort of the right to be in the public space. How can we bring women's rights to some of the places where the situation has been so bad for so long that it's really out of the discussion?
Well, certainly, from the Clinton Foundation's perspective, you know, if you go to noceilings.org, you'll see It's very clear kind of who the outliers are kind of in any of these dimensions. So whether it's kind of women's labor force participation, in which the United States is one of only 9 countries around the world to not have paid leave for mothers of new infants. You know, I think that's shameful. And you know, we are in the company of largely small island nation states in the South Pacific who have significantly fewer resources than we do to say that kind of we recognize the first few months in a child's life are critical to his or her future health, and also a mother's health as well. You know, similarly, you know, whether we're looking at Saudi Arabia or other countries in which women have fewer political participation rights, that's also equally called out. Whether it's kind of also then on the other side highlighting, as Anju was talking about, kind of areas that have made real progress by instituting quotas, you know, whether that's at the board level from an economic standpoint or a political level, in India where kind of village councils now have mandated 50% political participation. And that's made a tremendous difference in terms of how local councils are investing in education and healthcare, particularly around children and notably for girls.
So, and yet, how do you leverage the moral authority that we talked about earlier?
I think we shine a light on it. You know, so certainly, you know, we're doing everything we can to shine a light on it through our No Ceilings work and more broadly at the foundation, both talking about places where there hasn't been progress, but also highlighting places where there really has been progress. You know, India is often talked about as the place where there are tens of millions of child brides. I think it's important to also talk about kind of where India's made progress, hopefully to, in a not so subtle way, put positive pressure on places kind of where there's lots of progress to be made, to say you can make progress in some areas. You know, here are some examples so that we don't tend to think, oh gosh, there's so many gaps. Is I do think it's really important for us to have kind of the humility to recognize where we ourselves still have, you know, challenges to helping solve the gaps. And of course, they're not at the same level of Saudi Arabia. They're not at the same level of Niger, which has one of the highest child marriage rates in the world, where girls almost never graduate from secondary school. You know, it's not remotely to have a moral or strategic equivalency.
Yeah.
It's just to say, you know, nowhere are girls and women able to equally participate. We all have a responsibility. And I think for us in the United States, to be able to say about another country, you know, we think A, B, and C need to be done, we also have to be willing to say, here's what we think needs to happen in our own country.
Anju, do you want to dovetail on that? Do you want to go to the next?
No, I just wanted to add that, you know, we have learned over the last 20 years since Beijing that we have to find that right balance between holding people accountable by shining a light on the negative with the encouragement that you can give by modeling good behavior. And if you shine the light on the positives and really celebrate them, there's also a lot of advantage in bringing people along that way. And certainly on gender issues, you know, I lead gender at UNICEF, and I find when I want my health colleagues to work with me and my education colleagues and my water and sanitation colleagues to work with me, I get more done by showing them the good things that they're doing and how they can improve them than by wagging a finger at them and saying, you're not doing enough. So there is value to that as well.
More hands over here. Yes.
Hi, I'm Samantha Vinograd from Goldman Sachs. I've really enjoyed both of your comments on the global challenges that we face, but I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit about the challenges that women face here in the U.S., women and girls, and how we might address them. Thanks.
Sure. Well, I mean, we've talked about one, which I know that I am so emphatic about as a new mom, kind of, you know, the absence of paid maternal leave. I mean, something that we were talking about earlier as a possible topic was the whole field of STEM education and STEM participation.
How generous.
Yes, thank you, Santa Claus. A Commodore. Something that my daughter's never even going to understand what a Commodore is or was. And women were more than a third of computer science graduates. When I graduated from Stanford in 2001 in the heart of Silicon Valley, women were just under 21%. And last year, women were less than 13%. And so even while the denominator has grown, you know, that kind of more places are offering more degrees in the STEM fields and in computer science in particular, the number of women who are participating continues to shrink. And we know now a lot about why that is. And it starts pretty early on. So in first, second, and third grade, girls at the same rate as boys say that they want to kind of be astronauts or be engineers, build bridges, I mean, kind of all sorts of things that relate to STEM. That starts to change in fourth grade. And one of the reasons it may start to change is because in fourth grade, girls start getting called less in school by science and math teachers, both men and women science and math teachers. And so we know that we have a lot of work to do to ensure that kind of parents are helping their daughters kind of have kind of pretty resilient expectations, kind of that their opinions and ambitions in science and math are just as valued. And we know we need to do more kind of in teacher training to ensure that teachers are aware of kind of the unconscious biases that we all have, kind of not to stigmatize, but to help people kind of overcome those, you know, for their students. And then we know we need to do more to support kind of girls in later years as well. And a lot of it also comes back to closing the imagination gap. When Anju was talking about kind of being in India and kind of there being so many more girls in school, and what a radical difference that then makes to how girls and boys see the opportunities for girls. You know, we need more kind of STEM, you know, ideals and role models that look more like America. You know, I mean, I think kind of it is terrific that Mark Zuckerberg created Facebook when he was still in college, and that's an amazing incentive to kind of young people to kind of literally reimagine how we connect and live in the world. But we need more people that look like Anju in the STEM fields that are held up as real examples, because certainly, you know, when Pinterest is the only major company in Silicon Valley in which more than 20% of its engineers are women, and most of their user base are women, right? There's a real disconnect there. And thankfully, the Valley's really recognized this, and so we have more ancillary education while the public school system catches up to incorporating computer science, because it's kind of the analog to what we were talking about earlier, kind of with Japan. I mean, Google and the Valley recognizes, you know, it's in their long-term interest to ensure that more girls are learning about STEM, imagining themselves in STEM careers, because otherwise we're going to have a million open jobs in our country. Mm.
Mm-hmm. Because that's where the job creation is in those fields.
Absolutely.
And so women absolutely need to. It's fascinating to me because the most recent failed sexual discrimination suit in the Valley opened up a lot of this discussion, the gender biases that exist. Let's take, I'm going to, with you, with the,
Thank you. My name is Ronnie Goldberg. I'm with United States Council for International Business. Just a factoid. Last year in Brisbane, the G20 countries committed to raising women's labor market participation rates by 25% by the year 2025. What that means is open to question, but anyway, or how it's going to be implemented. Some years ago in this very room, the CFR hosted Benazir Bhutto. It was just before she was about to return to Pakistan, and she was anticipating, as you all know, running again to become prime minister. She was asked in that session what she would do differently in her second, if she had a second chance to be prime minister. And she said, I would govern more like a woman. She said, in my first term, I was so busy proving I was as tough as a man, as good as a man, as reliable as a man, that I ignored my instincts. For example, to put education higher on the priority list, and so on. So I wonder, perhaps this is a softball question, I wonder if you could reflect a little bit about women in power, in political power, and the opportunities and constraints that they have governing as women.
Well, never having held a political office, I can only talk about sort of what the research has said and what kind of others have said about their experiences, because I wouldn't be so kind of presumptuous to speak from my own experience, because it doesn't lend itself to that. A few kind of things that I was thinking about that while you were kind of sharing that remarkable anecdote from from Prime Minister Bhutto. One, if we look at Rwanda, which is often kind of viewed only through the prism of President Kagame, with more than 50% of its parliament now having been women for more than a decade, Rwanda's made radically different budgetary decisions than its neighbors have, both in terms of kind of investing in some of the fields that you talked about, health and education, and also making more long-term investments, making investments not over a 3 or 5 year horizon, but really over a 10 or a 20 year horizon. So I think this is just another way, as kind of we've all been talking about, where kind of having more women engaged and kind of more long-term thinking, as well as more sort of family and generational thinking, really does make a difference. And with Chancellor Merkel kind of recently advocating and then helping to pass the legislation in Germany, and that a third of companies listed in Germany companies in Germany have to have a third of their boards as women. Mm-hmm. She has said publicly that's something that she's long thought was the right thing to do, but it wasn't something that she was comfortable advocating for because she herself is a woman. And it took clearly years for her in office to get to a point where she felt comfortable actually doing what she thought was strategically and economically the right thing for Germany to do because of her own gender. So I think we see this in so many different ways, and it's something that we should be comfortable talking about and not pretending that it doesn't exist. It being both the biased and kind of it being the ways in which kind of women do make different decisions.
I'd be curious your thoughts. I mean, quota is often a dirty word, and yet it is often raised as a potential solution. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I think this point of the critical mass matters hugely, because when we look at the generations of women who go into power or into high-level jobs, when they are just one or two or a few, it's actually harder for them to be women, and I'm not so comfortable with having a woman mindset or a man mindset. There are plenty of men in power who have made very gender-friendly decisions and have been gender-aware too. But the point is that once you have company and you get to a comfort zone where it's not just your womanhood that's important in being power, women then can be more comfortable making those kinds of decisions, as Chelsea just said. The issue with quotas is that they're not perfect. We know that India is a great example. Some of it is being abused. There are men who are having their wives or their sisters and mothers represent them basically and holding on to power, but they have made a difference. Argentina is another example where this 40% quota changed in 10 years the entire political landscape, and it came with sort of this robust requirement that party lists had to have that quota. It wasn't just that women had to be elected, and it changed the whole way elections worked. And then seeing women in that space changes the culture. I mean, we sometimes say social norms take a long time to change, but sometimes social norms change overnight. I mean, for that kind of change to occur, when we see women in power, when we see our Supreme Court having not just one woman, then it becomes the established fact. This is something we can expect. More girls can aspire, more women can think this is the way to go. So we do have a long way to go, but these are the challenges that we need to address going forward.
Chelsea, you said having never held a public office, and the journalist in me can't help myself. Do you ever see yourself running for public office?
Yeah, no, I don't mind. I mean, this is a question that people have been asking me my whole life.
I'm sure. So I'm not the first, is what you're telling me.
I mean, one of my earliest memories, I mean, this is something that I've talked about publicly, it's true, is being a little girl. My dad was running for re-election as governor. Arkansas was the last state to move away from two-year gubernatorial election cycles. And so my father was often kind of balancing, kind of governing and campaigning. And I have this vivid memory of being in Magnolia, Arkansas. And I was waving a flag, because that was my role. Like when I was 3 or 4, I was like waving a flag. And this woman said, are you going to run for governor one day? And I was like, I'm 3 years old. Waving a flag. But it was awesome that she asked me.
Yes, there you go. That's actually
it was awesome
good.
That she asked me. I very much believe that my life at the moment is through the Clinton Foundation. It's kind of where I can best kind of think about, work on, and hopefully make a difference in issues that I care most about, like so much of what we're talking about here today. And I'm grateful that I live in a city and a state and a country where I support my elected officials. And so if any of those weren't true at some point, I'd have to ask myself if I thought I was the best person. But at the moment, I'm grateful for the life I have, and I'm grateful for the leadership that I live under.
And I'm also curious, you know, I think of Michelle Bachelet, right, or Benazir Bhutto, these women who whose signature policy initiatives are often surrounding girls, women, education. Is that the kind of presidency you think your mother would be casting?
Oh, I wouldn't speak for her. I certainly, though, I mean, my mother has been engaged in issues of early childhood education, as one example, since well before I was born. Mm. I mean, when she was a law student at Yale, she started working with the Yale Child Study Center and then the Children's Defense Fund. And so.
And children's rights.
And children's rights, right. And women's rights, and kind of access to more equitable and higher education and healthcare for low-income women and families. And so that's work that she's been doing, you know, for literally longer than the 35 years that I've been alive. I think that's more a testament to what she would focus on in her campaign or in office than anything that I could say.
Interesting. Okay, yes, right there.
Thank you. Peter Klatsky. I'm a fertility specialist, founder of Mama Rescue, which works on maternal mortality in East Africa. But I wanted to ask you a question about fertility and its relation to opportunity for women in the United States. As many people are aware, you mentioned gender participation, women's participation. It was 20% in 1950, rose to 55-60% by the end of the 20th century. That coincided with the rise of birth control pills, access to safe abortion. Currently, we're seeing another trend, which is this new arrival of a new technology, egg freezing. I believe the disparities in pay gap between men and women, which is, I think, 77 cents on the dollar, exist across all age groups except in the demographic 38 to 42, single without a child. I'm curious to get your opinion and perspective as to whether you think that increasing access to egg freezing will actually promote women's participation. You both mentioned long-acting reversible contraception and ways to prevent early pregnancy as ways to enhance women's participation in the workforce. How does this relate to women's reproductive rights and rights in the workplace?
So a few kind of quick thoughts. There is a big conversation that I think is a healthy one around kind of what should insurers cover, or what should kind of large employers who are self-insured cover for their employees. And I absolutely agree kind of with your underlying premise that to kind of facilitate and support kind of women's full participation, kind of women's reproductive rights have to be kind of fully guaranteed and supported. And I think that does include, you know, optionality. I also think it's important that kind of more young women kind of be aware of the fact that we've lost ground in this country on reproductive rights and access to safe and legal abortion rights. And sadly, kind of that recognition is not as widely spread as I think kind of many of us would hope, and I see kind of many heads nodding. You know, millennial women do not know that these rights are being taken away. They do not know that kind of in many states, you know, already women who are marginalized because of kind of where they live, their socioeconomic status, are those on whom these kind of reversal of rights are falling most hard. And so that this isn't just, again, a women's rights issue, this is a human rights issue in a very kind of fundamental sense. So I think it's both about kind of ensuring that insurance companies and kind of large self-insured employers are taking responsibility for asking these sorts of questions and ensuring that kind of the bias is toward kind of increasing access and kind of meaningful access to different options that may be right for different women at different points in our lives. But it's also about ensuring that even younger women beyond the 38 to 42 year olds kind of are aware of the legal and political environments that we're living within, so that we don't become any more complacent than sadly so many are. Because it's not just about insurance, it's also about ensuring that we have kind of the legal rights and agencies to make the right choices for ourselves.
Anju, do you want to piggyback on that? Or
no, just that I couldn't agree more. And, you know, I used to teach at a university in a course on gender, and I would always start the class with girls, women, and boys, men, all sort of saying, we don't have gender inequality in the United States. Why should we worry about this? And it's when we reached these questions of not guaranteed reproductive rights, the wage gap, the issues that our policies are almost behind our culture. You know, we have had a generation that has grown up accepting the fact that you can have a child when you feel like it, when you're ready, when you can invest in your career and so forth. But now those issues are more and more questioned, and we need to really have our young women and men grow up realizing that these are threats to their rights, and that they are going to have to defend if they want to continue with the lifestyle or have the life options that they have had the freedom to engage in the last generation.
We're going to take one last question right here with the scarf.
Great. Thank you. Ali Mazzara with the State University of New York. And we're very fortunate, I'm with the Office of Global Affairs, we're very fortunate to have a grant from the Jewish Foundation for Educational Women for SUNY undergraduate women of all faiths to pursue careers in international relations and global affairs. So I'd like to ask our speakers if they would recommend or highlight certain things these young women should think about as they're going into the world, graduating this year, next year. They're lawyer, pre-law, pre-med, human rights interests, as well as engineers and other areas. So I'd love to bring your advice back to them. Thank you.
Well, I will just start by saying that we should be encouraging, I'm pleased to see that that's the route in front of them. Having both concrete, tangible skills in things like finance, in STEM, in really being able to understand numbers, statistics, those things matter as much as being able to understand the soft side of how diplomacy works, how political negotiation works, but how personal relations and culture works as well. And in some ways, I think the best equipped generation is the one that can bring those two things together.
I think that's absolutely, you know, such salient advice. I mean, I'm thrilled that so many of your students want to go into kind of work like Anju is doing, or work like what we're doing through No Ceilings at the Foundation. And I would hope there's some men, too, who are similarly inspired and motivated. And I would just kind of add to what Anju was saying in that, kind of going back to my mom, who, you know, Juju's talked about kind of throughout this morning for understandable reasons. You know, my mother has been working on issues of early childhood development and women's rights for so many decades now, and she's been able to do that in many different ways. And so kind of through NGO work, through her legal aid work, through her work as a lawyer, through her work as First Lady, as a Senator, Secretary of State. And I would urge your students to think about, even if they kind of go into finance, to think about how they can still engage with these issues kind of through their employers, or kind of even just as an informed voter, that even if they don't work in kind of these fields of the cold face of so many of what, you know, the issues that motivate kind of us here today, they can still have an impact. And they can have an impact today, and kind of by learning some of the functional skills that Anju was talking about, arguably they can have even more of an impact in the future.
Thank you so much. One of the sticklers of the council, as we all know, is that we have to end on time. I can't thank Anju Malhotra enough, and Chelsea Clinton, both
thank
of you.
Thank you very much.
Fabulous remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much.